Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We're in the EOC in here as well as at Dakota Valley School. We're here for a media briefing, updates on flood situations along the Missouri River. I'd like to open by introducing Governor Dennis Dugard. Governor?
Good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining us for this press conference today about flooding along the Missouri River in South Dakota. The first message I'd like to offer today is one of thanks to all South Dakotans up and down the river who have proven, again, their great self-reliance and their independence. And in South Dakota, we recognize that government provides things that citizens cannot provide for themselves. And in many ways, we've seen how citizens up and down the Missouri River have provided for themselves with the help of their family and friends, and it makes me very proud to be part of a state like that. The other message I want to give at the outset is a reminder about safety, and I know it seems like it's a record replaying again and again, but I want to mention a couple of specifics. Last month in Rapid City, we saw the death of a young boy who was playing beside the river, playing beside Rapid Creek. And as the river comes up and as its tributaries come up, there will be a great interest in looking at that flowing water, and especially among children, in playing in or near the water. And that represents a very serious safety threat. There have been deaths of children in Utah in recent weeks as a consequence of playing by flooded waters. And so again, in South Dakota, please keep personal safety uppermost in your mind and watch your children and keep them away from the river. The other specific that I want to remind us of is the breach of Iowa levees that occurred earlier this week. It reminds us that even permanent levees that were built and are more stable after years of existence can breach and do breach, and thus also may our temporary, urgently and rapidly constructed levees breach. And so please, as you look to approach your home or business that's within an area that's protected by a levee, I encourage you to do so with caution. Please do so only during daylight hours. Please do not sleep overnight in a home that's behind a levee. It's one thing to be awake and able to retreat to higher ground. If the water starts rising, it's a whole nother thing to be asleep in your home and have that happen at night. Keep your personal safety uppermost in your mind. With those overarching themes, I want to offer some specific information. The National Guard was activated very shortly after this flood event became known to us, and we activated over 1,000 National Guard soldiers, well over 1,000, as the sandbagging demands and traffic control demands have ebbed. We are continuing to right-size the National Guard force. We've sent the Chinook helicopter home to Illinois. It has done its work lugging sandbags by air. The enduring role of the South Dakota National Guard will continue to be levee surveillance, both in Pierre and Fort Pierre and on the levees in southeast South Dakota, as well as to provide a quick response force to address levee issues. We have daily levee issues that arise, plastic repair, boil repair, groundwater issues that the Guard is alert to and alerts the quick response force to address. And in some cases, we arrange for private contractors to manage further. In other cases, the Guard is able to address it completely. The Guard will also be involved in air operations, will continue to maintain a Black Hawk helicopter in the Pierre Fort Pierre area, as well as in the southeast area, Each of them will be equipped with a hoist for their ability to evacuate in case of a medical emergency. They'll also be able to move sandbags with their other hook, I guess. The second point I wanted to make today is we were very glad to have Robin Finnegan, the regional administrator in Denver, who's responsible for our region. She visited Fort Pierre yesterday and then also went on to the southeast area yesterday late afternoon and was there again still this morning, went home this morning. While she was in South Dakota, she visited and was on the ground to tour levees at both reaches below both dams. She also toured by air those levee systems and saw in both areas those homes that are inundated and not protected by levees, both those in upstream areas of Fort Pierre and downstream areas of Pierre, as well as River's Edge and other inundated areas in the southeast. We are gathering data through our emergency managers and our communities of those homes which are either uninhabitable or have sustained damage, and certainly those that are completely inundated, to provide information to FEMA so that it may form part of an application for individual assistance. And so we ask those homeowners who are in the affected areas to provide information to your county emergency manager, and in some cases you may be referred to a city employee who is collecting that information. Is your home inundated with water? How deep is the water? Is your basement damaged? Is your home inaccessible? Information like that is being collected and will form a part of our effort for application to get individual assistance. The third item I just want to mention, it's been the subject of a news release. On Friday, we're having a forum here in Pierre, where I am today. That forum will help business owners address how the flooding has impacted their business and what things might become or are available to help businesses deal with the financial ramifications or practical impacts of the flood. That forum is at 1:30 at the Matthews Training Center here in Pierre, and we are planning to do another similar forum in the southeast later. If you have questions as a business owner that you would like to email in advance that will make more likely our ability to answer them at the forum, please email your questions on the disaster recovery webpage. That's disaster recovery at sd.gov. So those are the three things, and I'll stand by for questions later.
Thank you, Governor. We'll next hear from Army Corps of Engineers, Lee J. Templeton.
Good morning, Lee J. Templeton, U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. I'll first start out with the report from Oahe. Current reservoir elevation is at 1618.57, and that's held pretty steady over the last 24 hours. We currently have the outflow rate is at 150,000 CFS, and that's scheduled to maintain into mid-August. The inflow from Garrison, the current discharge from the Garrison Dam, which is the majority of the inflow into Lake Oahe, is being maintained today at 140,000 CFS. Tomorrow we'll step up to 145,000 CFS. And on Friday, it'll reach its max flow rate of 150,000 CFS. Gavin's Point, the reservoir elevation there as of midnight last night was at 1207.44, and it's up slightly over the last 24 hours. Because of that, we're maintaining the flow rate out of Fort Randall to draw that down slightly. We're trying to have a target reservoir elevation of 1206.5, and we'll make adjustments for out of Fort Randall until we reach that. A little information on the snowpack still to come into the system. Information from a graph that shows that is tied to the 30-year average for this date and time should be about 4 water equivalent inches, And currently, we still have around 13 water equivalent inches to come into the system between the basically the reach above Fort Peck. From Fort Peck to Gavin to the Garrison Dam, that reach, the 30-year average is about 5 inches for this time, for this date and time. And currently, we have just under 14 inches of water equivalent still to come into the system. That's the end of my report. Thank you.
Thank you, Lee J. Now we'll go to community reports, and we'll start here in Pierre with Pierre Mayor Lori Gill.
All right, good morning. In Pierre, we want to continue to thank the public. When we were first entering this event, we were asking homeowners and individuals to protect your property and your families as if there would be no government help. And generally, as a community, people heeded our warning and did that. So we continue to thank you for your efforts. It was well worth the time and effort. Public safety and the stability of our utilities remain our top concern, particularly as we're moving ahead with decision making. As we go through each day and the levees hold and everything's secure, we are getting more requests for folks to consider asking if they can move into their homes or if we can, as a community, resume activities that we used to do and had planned for this summer. And once again, public safety remains our top focus as we are making our decisions. We do have levees that are passing inspection. We are monitoring them regularly. They are holding, but they are levees and they are temporary. And we do want to remind people to keep that in mind as you are making your decisions. The levees in Pierre are transitioning to the city of Pierre. We will be in charge of the ownership and the control of the levees moving on into the future, but we do have in place regular monitoring, and the South Dakota National Guard continues to participate. And thank you to them for helping us to monitor the levees and the safety of them as we move on into the future. Stormwater continues to be something that the community is watching. We've had a couple of rain events in the last week that have produced no significant challenges to us. We've used them as testing to be able to monitor our pumping system that we have in place. We have 19 stormwater pumps that are being monitored on a 24-hour basis, and we are partnering, the city and Morris Incorporated are partnering to keep our eyes on those pumps in the event we have a major rain event. We are continuing to watch the water that's flowing into the stormwater drainage system. We are allowing lawn watering at this time, but we're telling folks to please help us and don't water such that water goes into the streets. You can do it if you can maintain the water in your lawn and on your flowers, but we're still asking to keep water out of the streets at this time because that is what's helping to overload our storm drainage system. I also would reiterate that the City of Pierre homeowners that are seeing water damage or inundation, we are collecting that information through our county emergency manager. And in Hughes and Stanley County, that is Rob Fines. We're asking folks to either give him a call or send an email. That is information that will be very helpful as FEMA moves into the first step of the individual assistance program for homeowners. Rob Fines can be reached at 773-7454, or you can email him at rob.fines@co.hughes.sd.us. And that ends my peer report.
Thank you, Mayor Gill. Well, next go to Fort Pierre Mayor Sam Tidball. Sir?
Thank you, Terry. The our levees seem to be performing really quite well. There doesn't seem to be any major problems. We are getting some groundwater, of course. It's to be expected. I caution people not to be too concerned if you see a little water in your backyard or around the in the street. Don't be too excited about that, but if it's any significant quantity, we want to know about that. But there's going to be some groundwater infiltrate through the sand from the river. Storm drains, we still have some inflow in some of our storm drains, but we're gaining on those. And I just want to say that people are really showing their determination and stamina in coping with the situation that we have. We've been working with FEMA to lay the groundwork to get individual and infrastructure support. FEMA has pledged support in all situations that are within their statutory authority, and they've been very pleasant to work with. We urge our business owners to attend the forum that the governor mentioned, to submit questions to the forum at 11:30 on Friday. That's an opportunity to share some information. I would just say a word of caution: anyone with damage, water damage in their home, be sure and contact Rob Fiennes, as Mayor Gill has mentioned. He also has a cell phone number that's 280-1050. We are working sizing and locating large pumps where rainwater will collect in case of a hard rain. So we're getting prepared for that. One of the things, if you're going to need help in cleaning up after the flood, I urge everyone to use local service people that are in the community if at all possible. Avoid the fly-by-night contractors, or at least check them out very thoroughly. I particularly want to thank everyone for their great cooperation and upbeat attitude in spite of adversity. We are planning to go ahead with the 4th of July parade, fireworks, and most likely the rodeo. I just say, keep up the good fight and be positive. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Kidball. Now we'll move down to the southeast part of this flood fight, and there Sandy Prince, Public Information Officer, will coordinate comments from the folks gathered at Dakota Valley School. Sandy?
Good morning, and greetings from the Dakota Valley High School. We do have several people joining us today that have messages and updates. I'll be introducing those to you as we progress through our presentation, but I did want to let everybody know that we have also been joined by Josh Wendling. Josh is the president of the Windstone Community Homeowners Association. He will be available for questions when we get to our question and answer period. With that, we'd like to begin with Jeff Dooley. Jeff is the Dakota Dunes Community Improvement District Manager.
Thank you, Sandy. Before I get started, I just want to take a brief opportunity to thank everybody involved in the flood control efforts here in the southeast part of the state, from the governor to the lieutenant governor to the National Guard to the state troopers to South Dakota DOT to Union County, all the way down to the residents themselves. Without your leadership and help, none of this could be possible. We couldn't have got to the point we are today without all that help. So I really want to stress our appreciation for your efforts and leadership. our situation in Dakota Dunes is very similar to what it sounds like it is in Fort Pierre. Our levees are up. We're doing some minor maintenance items to them. And we're basically right now in a monitoring stage of that process. And the National Guard is assisting us in the monitoring and response to any problems that we have. And that's greatly appreciated. The dewatering system that we have in place is operational. And we are achieving some of the elevations that we want within the evacuation zone. For the most part, our goal was basically to maintain a water level, groundwater level in there that supports the levee while trying to minimize other damage. So the dewatering is in place. We have similar problems with some storm sewers that we periodically have to replug and keep an eye on. We are also asking our residents to minimize irrigation, not only to help our storm sewer, but we know right now we're getting our water from Sioux City, and we want to minimize the impact on the city of Sioux City's water system as well. As we developed the levee system and the dewatering project, once we had to evacuate people from the southern part of Dakota Dunes, the management team has always been thinking about how can we get some of those residents back into their homes to monitor their situation and effect mitigation repairs. Last night we had a meeting with those residents to kind of outline a plan that will allow them re-entry into the evacuation zone to analyze their property, to assess it, and to develop plans to try to mitigate problems. You know, the general feeling in the meetings from the residents were they were very happy that they were going to be allowed back in. They understand the restraints or the restrictions. And they're just looking forward to a chance to get in there and help mitigate damage. Also, Mid-American Energy is working to try to restore power in areas of the dunes where it's practical, and they will continue to do that and to monitor the situation to allow for more power to additional areas as we go through the process. Safety is and always will be our number one concern as we allow people back into the evacuated zone, as we monitor the levees, all the processes involved in this project. Safety is our number one concern, and we have to keep in mind that we do have a levee system. It's charged with water behind it, and it can be a very volatile situation, and we have to monitor that on a day-to-day, hour-to-hour basis. To make sure that the conditions within that area are safe, and we'll continue that policy safety first throughout this process. So, with that, I'll stand down and wait for questions. Thanks.
Thank you, Jeff. Don Fuchs is the mayor of North Sioux City, and he's here to deliver a message.
Thank you, Sandy. On behalf of the McCook Lake North Sioux City residents, we would also like to thank Governor Dugard, Lieutenant Governor Matt Michaels, their team on the ground here that have been supporting and implementing a lot of the things that have happened here. The National Guard, South Dakota Patrol, Union County, Dakota Valley High Schools, and our city employees, our residents and volunteers, would also like to thank them as well. As far as the infrastructure goes in the McCook Lake, North Sioux City area, it's operating as normal. Our city staff are standing by 24 hours a day monitoring the situation, and they will respond as the need arises. The levees from the south end of McCook Lake through Mud Lake, Adams Nature Area connecting to Windstone, have been completed and are being patrolled by the National Guard. And for the residents of North Sioux City and the McCook Lake area, if you would just please refer to the City of North Sioux City's website for any updates. That will be the best way for you to get the information. That's all from the McCook Lake, North Sioux City area, and I'll stand by for questions.
Thank you. The next person you'll be hearing from is Ray Rogo. Ray is the Union County Emergency Manager.
Just a few points from Union County Emergency Management. First of all, we can only resound what has already been heard from the other divisions here, other entities, that we have such great teamwork down in this community for the last 15 days, 16 days, and we will continue that. Very proactive from everyone to be together and work in one fight for this incident. One of the things that I would like to touch is just briefly, we have been working with law enforcement with this credentialing system that we've put into place, and I know that will be touched on in more detail in just a little bit, but we're trying to work with law enforcement and with the CID, with Jeff down here, to make sure that those folks are able to get back into their properties for an assessment. One thing that we want to pass on from Union County is the fact that we have so many information opportunities out there. We have the our Union County webpage, which is just unionsd.org. We have a flood page up on that. We have many, many pieces of information on there from locally, and also links into different areas that are so important to everyone. One thing that we want to mention for public information is also the call center that we set up. Those numbers changed this last Monday morning, and the call center now, the number for that, for the Union County Flood Hotline, is 1-888-869-9975. Anyone that has a question, please direct it to that number, and it will get answered. If not immediate, it will get back to you as soon as possible. Also, at Liberty National Bank down here, we still have our IMAT team, our South Dakota IMAT team in place down there. And at that point, we have a trailer in the lot, a parking lot out there. We have a public information office in there that Sandy is manning. So anyone that needs to can stop there for more information also. And everyone has heard previously, but I want to pass this on. We don't want to forget the website for the BeReadySD.com. All of these sites have so much information out there, and we don't want to be holding anyone up to retrieve that. So mark these down and go to those links. It's so important to pass that information on. And that is probably what I have for this time. Thanks.
Thanks, Ray. And then finally, to address some of the issues around logistics of re-entering into our evacuated community, we'll be joined by Major Randy Hartley. He is with the South Dakota Highway Patrol, and he has been serving as our incident commander.
Good morning. At the beginning of the event in the southeast, a Type 2 emergency management team was brought in to kind of coordinate and manage the quickly evolving emergency. And I would like to take the opportunity to thank them for the excellent work that they did in building the levee and the management of the incident up to this point. Yesterday, we transitioned to a Type 3 team in the southeast area. The Type 3 team's function is to assist the local governmental agencies in continuing to manage the incident and eventually to transition back into a normal governmental operation. As Jeff mentioned, from the beginning of this event, we were concerned about the residents and trying to allow them access to their home. It's never an easy situation when you have to do an evacuation, and there's always a concern that you want to let people have access as quickly as possible. It's been kind of an ongoing coordinated effort, but beginning tomorrow, Thursday at 10 o'clock, we're going to let residents back into their back to their residents to check on the conditions and you know, do the things that may be necessary, things that may have not gotten done at the time of the evacuation. Only those that are residences, that are residents of Dakota Dunes, are going to be allowed into their residence. They must have the ID system that the emergency management team has put into place, and they must have a government-issued ID, photographic ID with that in order to get back in. We recommend that they use a higher profile vehicle or an SUV. They will have to cross over the top of the north portion of the levee in order to get to their residence. Everyone must check in at the checkpoint on Dakota Dunes Boulevard, and they must check out when they leave. There is a requirement for us to manage who is inside the levee and who is not. As Jeff indicated, the situation is still hazardous. There's going to be water inside. There's still maintenance that's going on the levee. There's still going to be patrols that are going on the levee, and so we must account for everybody that goes in and goes out. We understand that everyone is anxious to get into the Dakota Dunes area and take a look at their homes, but we would encourage people not to try and all go in at 10 o'clock. Frankly, the situation, the circumstance of your residence is going to be the same, you know, if you wait a half hour, if you wait an hour. And we would encourage those that can to maybe wait a little bit and not try and all enter at the same time. We will allow contractors to go into the area if they have the proper credentials. In order for a contractor to get into the levee system, they will have to have a written authorization from a resident, and it will have to specify who the contractor is and the residence that they're going to. We would also ask that residents who do go into the Dakota Dunes area go to their home and remain as close to their home as practical, going in and going out. We expect that there's going to be a lot of activity inside the levee structure, and we want to maintain the security for everyone that's involved in that. We would ask that they try and confine to the area that they live. We would ask that everyone use caution and to notify law enforcement or the emergency operations center if they notice anything out of the ordinary that is hazardous, that is dangerous, that they feel is a concern. We would like to know about that right away. And I will be glad to stand by for questions.
Okay, we'll come back to Pier in the Emergency Operations Center. And to do this, we will start here with some questions. We will move down to Dakota Valley for some questions. We'll do questions from the phone. Please be patient. We'll try to get to all of you. And we'll start here in the Emergency Operations Center. Any questions here? DJ Tony,
you talked about the 13 inches of rain, you know, that is supposed to still be coming from the snow melt. How can you do that without using the emergency spillway at the Owyhee Dam?
Well, the water equivalent inches that are located up in the mountains comes in at a particular rate. And that rate is following along that same slope as it has in years past. And the models that are done down in the district office and or down in the division office account for that. And they do that model every day, and they take into account the speed at which the inflows occur. So with the current models that we get updates every single day on, the current flow rates as has been posted is still in effect and still true.
I'm not sure I understand what you mean when you say we have 13 more inches to come through the system. Do you mean there's 13 more inches of moisture that needs to come all the way down? Okay. I'm sorry, I don't understand.
Sure. Snowpack has different density, and depending upon the density, but we know when we measure it, we can reduce it down to its water equivalent inches. So right now we know we have a lot of snow still in the mountains that's going to inflow into the system, and we can measure and put it on the same level depending if it's, you know, the snowpack is 10 feet or if it's 5 feet, reduce it down to the water equivalent, and that's how we gauge how much is left to come into the system. We have averages. We have a graph that shows us what we can expect, and we take the last 30 years, put it on a graph, and then we compare each year either we're above or below that average, and that can tell us to help us predict on the flow rates coming into the system.
So just so I'm clear on that, I mean, obviously this is a whole different issue, okay? I mean, this year. I mean, would the models that you guys have been talking about fit this kind of year?
Every year is different when it comes to the snowpack. Sometimes we're above, sometimes we're below. For the reaches above Fort Peck, it peaked at 141% of normal. Above, let me make sure that I got the number right. Yep, 141% above Fort Peck was the peak percentage, and that is in relation to the 30-year average on April 15th. For the reach between Fort Peck and Garrison, it was 136% of the average over that 30-year period. So I know in the media you've seen a lot of large numbers, but these are the numbers that we've calculated in those reaches.
For the two mayors, we've talked about levees, and the levees are strong. In the worst-case scenario, if the levees do break or we have a malfunction, is there a plan, do the cities have plans to notify the public and how that would work, and could you explain that a little bit?
We do have an emergency plan ready to deal with levee breaks and so forth if there's something that occurs like that. So that we have standby crew doing that. National Guard, I think, is our primary source for that right at the present time.
And that's the same in Pier. We have our quick response teams that are ready to go, and they have an information flow that will go through our system. Our dispatch would be notified immediately, and we have a method to notify the local media as well to get that word out. So we have a plan that is in place, and we would be ready as well if there was something that would happen.
I have a question regarding the storm sewers. The other day down in Missouri, I noticed someone was pumping water out of their basement, and they had the sump pump pouring it into the storm sewer. Now, I know everyone's been saying don't add additional water to the storm sewer. Where Where are they supposed to put the water?
That's a good question, and that is an exception to our request to not put water in the storm sewer. We are asking that the sump pumps do go into the street, because then our city system can pick it up and pump it out.
Yes, well, we do the same thing in Fort Pierre, only we do have quite a few people on the river pumping it directly out into the river over the levees. So, but that is a concern, and we try to keep in monitoring that circumstance, so keep that water down.
Okay, one or two more questions here.
Mayor, just one quick question. You said, you know, the lawns, you know, I know you had also said early on, don't wash vehicles. I mean, can people wash their vehicles now or not?
We are asking for homeowners to refrain from any activity that puts water into the street, with the exception we just talked about. And so any activity, just use common sense, whatever it might be. Refrain from sending water onto your sidewalk and into the street.
Governor, do you have a cost yet? I mean, I know you're putting together totals for all the flooding. Are you close to yet having a final estimate or an estimate at this point as far as flood costs?
I don't have a roll up today because I just got in. I was in the Dakota Dunes area this morning and got in a little bit ago, so I don't have a roll up today. But within the last couple days, the total amount of state costs, this is just state costs, is in excess of $10 million. More than $5 million of that is National Guard activation costs. The cost per day of the Guard will continue to decline as we right size, as we reduce air operations. So the cost per day is going down. It'll go down today, presuming the levees continue to hold down in the southeast area. After we're at 150 yesterday, we feel the effects of it at the dunes area today. In a couple of days, if the levees are still in good condition, we'll right size still further down there. But that'll reduce the cost per day. Another fact in that 10 is over $1 million in sandbags, for example. The cost to staff the emergency operations center here, the cost to staff the emergency operations center for the southeast area. Again, those staff costs will begin to decline significantly as we pass the frenzied levee building sandbagging period into a period of watchfulness and response to particular events. The staffing will go down at both centers and the Guard, and the cost per day will go down. But we're over $10 million at the state level. Each local government then incurs its costs as well. So the Dakota Dunes Improvement District has incurred a lot of costs to build their levee. The southern section, the city of Pierre, the city of Fort Pierre have also incurred costs to build levees beyond those that the Corps financed, and they've got overtime costs with their staff. They've got cost to rent pumps, cost to fuel those pumps, all kinds of costs like that. And so the number I just gave you is the state cost.
Okay, one last question.
What is the target elevation for the Oahe Dam? What are you aiming for there?
The models that I've seen put us up about 16, 19.2, 0.3. We do not anticipate going over or having to use the spillway or getting close to that 1620 elevation where we'd have to use the spillway.
And then where are we at as far as National Guard from the peak? I know a lot of them have been sent home.
I can give you numbers. And Pierre, we're down to 265 National Guard. In the southeast area, we're at 536. In 2 days, we'll be down to 405. Presuming the levees hold here in the next 2 days at the 150 CFS rate. So we'll be down to a total of about 670 statewide.
And that's from a peak of?
Peak of over 1,300. So it's cut in about half.
Thank you.
Thank you, Governor. We'll now turn down to Dakota Valley School if Sandy's ready to see if there are questions on there. Sandy?
Thank you. We do have several media guests in the audience with us today. We ask that if you have a question, you please use the microphone we have available for you, and please identify where you're from. Do we have any questions? Okay, at this time we don't have any audience questions.
Thank you. Then we'll come back.
Questions from the phone. Would you mind identifying yourself? Be patient, speak up so that we hear you, and if you can, suggest who you'd like to ask the question of. Go ahead.
Hi, this is Dirk Lammers with AP. I'm just curious if the 150,000 CFS from Gavin's Point, is it yet reaching the Dakota Dunes area? And is there any indication of how the levees are reacting to that at this point?
Our river values this morning
were at 1093.39, which was actually a slight decrease from where we were at yesterday, down about 0.24 feet, while we did see slight increases at Yankton, Gayville, and Mescal. So the water is starting to arrive at this point, and so far the levees are behaving the way we expected the levees to behave, and they're holding up nicely.
Thank you. I'm sorry. Who is that answering?
I'm sorry. This is Sandy.
Thank you, Sandy.
Cody Winchester at the Argus Leader in Sioux Falls. This is for Mr. Templeton. To clarify, just based on the Corps' most current projection, there are no plans to increase flows out of any of the dams to more than 150,000 CFS?
That is correct.
Okay. And what one of this, I'm not sure who this would be, maybe Jeff or Ray or maybe Randy. You sort of outlined that you have a plan for reentry into the evacuation zones. Could you be a little more specific about the criteria for determining whether a home is safe enough to let people back in?
Do you hear the question down there?
Yes, we did. Randy's coming up to answer.
Okay.
Throughout the event, we have continued to monitor the homes. We have been all around the Dakota Dunes area, and it's been our determination that there isn't really any home in the Dakota Dunes area that the resident can at least take a look at. There are some safety concerns that would be probably identified to a particular resident, but it's our determination at this time that every resident can at least be observed. There are going to be some that are going to have water. There's going to be some that are going to have a difficult access point, but they can all be at least examined.
Okay. One final question. Have there been any incidents so far of people trying to re-enter the evacuated zones without authorization?
I'll bet most people can guess the answer to that one. Yes, there has.
I'm sorry, what was that?
Yes, there has been. There have been some that have gotten in without permission, but we have handled them, and there hasn't been a great number. As a matter of fact, I would take the opportunity to really commend the residents of Dakota Dunes and Riverland. During the evacuation, they have been excellent as far as cooperation that we have received from them. But there have been some that have gotten in and have had to be removed.
And was the result of that an arrest or just sort of turning them out?
No, we have not arrested anyone. We've also not had a repeat offender.
Okay, thank you.
Kevin Wooster with the Rapid City Journal. A question for Mayor Gill. You had mentioned that the levees and pier are transitioning ownership and control of the city. If they break, is then that all the city's responsibility, or how does that work?
Yeah, the actual, as I said, ownership and control is transitioning to the city. We will continue to monitor and to repair. I think, you know, general liability issues are the same as if there weren't a levee, actually. We've got flooding that's occurring in our community, and we're doing the best that we can to mitigate that. So that's about the best I can say about that right now.
But the Corps of Engineers essentially is out of that picture now in terms of repairs and costs and things?
Yeah, and this I'm being told, is a common practice when the Corps of Engineers puts up a temporary levee in a community. This is part of the process that at some point the levee transitions to the local jurisdiction.
And Mayor Tidball, are you transitioning as well there?
We haven't as yet. We expect that'll happen in the next few days.
Thank you.
Kevin, this is the governor. I'd like to also mention, however, that the Corps maintains a presence in the communities where there are levees and have provided technical support at every opportunity where we've needed that. So if we have a boil inside the Dakota Dunes levee, for example, that was not one they built, but is something that is protecting the community, the Corps has been very good about helping us understand whether to build a mini levee to contain that boil or whether to lay down a seepage blanket using sand and then more coarse material and compacting that, and how to handle each problem as it arises. We're getting good technical help from the Corps.
And Governor, are none of the levees at Dakota Dunes Corps levees, or some of them?
The southern segment was built by the community, and the northern segment was built by the Corps.
Thank you.
Further questions? Any more questions on the phone?
This is Michelle Link at the Sioux City Journal.
Okay.
I'm wondering, you talked about alerting the dispatch centers of local law enforcement and then the leaders, but is there some kind of, will, for instance, tornado sirens or something be used to warn people, you know, that a levee has been breached and, you know, to find out why, where, and, you know, take cover kind of thing?
We have talked about using sirens. However, in Pierre, there is such a long system of levees that if we did a siren, it was would be very hard to tell people through that method exactly where the issue was in the community. So it was determined that the quicker way to get it out was our going through our quick response teams and getting messaging right away to dispatch so that we can start to get the word out through all methods that are available to us using the media. But the use of those sirens has been very careful. Discussed. We have also suspended the use in Pierre of the sirens for other things that we had been using them for, such as the 10 o'clock curfew whistle, that kind of thing, so that we can continue to use it for the severe weather, so that people don't get confused in the messaging with several potential events that are going on.
Okay, and how about at Dakota Dunes?
This area.
Raymond Rogo, Union County Emergency Management. We tested the sirens yesterday at the dunes area, and they are on battery, and they are working. We are using two different tones. We are using the flat tone for tornadoes, of that sort of an incident, but we are using the high-low tones for a breach of levee. So, that information is out in the pamphlets that we are giving to the residents as they go in today, or tomorrow, excuse me. And so we have that information out and about.
It's on the phone. If not, we'll call an end to this. We thank you for participating. I will be sending out some information soon about future briefings. And thanks very much. We appreciate you being here. We'll talk to you again.